Hello and welcome to the France 24 interview. My guest today is Kristalina Georgieva. She is the Managing Director of the International Monetary Fund. Thank you very much for being with us.
Thank you for having me.
On the radar screen these days, the coronavirus in China. The IMF just put out its forecast, 6% growth for China in 2020. Will this impact Chinese growth and more broadly, global growth?
We are following very closely the developments in China. It is too early to quantify what the impact might be. We know from previous cases like the SARS epidemics that there could be short-term negative impact and then a rebound. Whether this would be the case now, we have to carefully follow up and see. But it makes a very important broader point that we live in a world with more uncertainties. And so we have to get that to be our new normal. We are still in the first month of the year. We had forest fires in Australia, the impact of climate change. We had tensions in the Middle East that for a short period of time did unravel the markets and created trouble for many. Luckily, that went down. Now we have the coronavirus. So our broad message is that we have to work for policies that build more resilience to shocks.
Right. But it seems that if this continues, it will have an impact on Chinese growth, on regional growth, and maybe on global growth.
If it continues in a way that is unabated for some time, we will see impact. Even if it is stopped tomorrow, there has already been a short-term negative impact on the tourism industry, also on manufacturing, when factories had to stop production for a while. It all depends on how potent the measures are to contain the epidemics from spreading. And this is still too early to say. But the message to everyone is, as much as possible, think of prevention, think of protection, think of early action.
Right. China was also pretty much on the radar screens because of the trade tensions with the US. There was an agreement, a partial agreement, some may say, that eased the tensions and prompted the IMF to have a higher forecast, actually, before the coronavirus for Chinese growth. Do you think this is all behind or it's still pretty much in the air?
It is a very welcoming step to reduce tensions between the two large economies, US, China. We actually calculated the cost of war between China and the US at 0.8% of global GDP. This is the equivalent of the economy of Switzerland, $700 billion. What we can say today is that with the reduction of tensions, we are able to shrink that negative impact from 0.8 to 0.4, 0.5%, but not to zero. Why? Because one, the impact of uncertainty has already inflicted some pain on the world economy. Two, we have trade truce, but it is not the same as trade peace. There are some fundamental issues in our global trade system that need to be addressed. They relate to including services, e-commerce, dealing with technology transfer more permanently. And we want to see the second phase of this agreement. For this, both China and US, but also the rest of the world, we need to work hard for a trade system that turns trade again in the powerful engine of growth we have accustomed for it to be.
Right. I mean, we saw, obviously, the Trump administration push hard on China. We're seeing also tensions. We are here in Brussels with the European Union. Are you fearing a trade war between the EU and the US? Some would say it has already started.
Many of us were in Davos, where the first interactions between the new president of the European Commission and the president of the United States were seen as positive signals of willingness to prevent deepening of the tensions between actually great partners, traditionally US, Europe. We also know that fear of digital tax turning into the next source of uncertainty for the world economy have receded. The important message for all of us is trade is good for growth, it is good for jobs, it is good for the poor people in all countries because it brings prices down. We have an obligation to work for a sound trade system.
Right. Is the President of the United States committed to that?
We saw a very constructive posture from the U.S. administration during the last This is a very welcomed change, and I think there is a recognition that we almost limped into recession in the world, and we all have an obligation in our own self-interest to avoid that. Let me just tell you that 2019 was the lowest growth year since the financial crisis, 2.9%. If we didn't have the synchronized action of central banks, 49 central banks cutting interest rates 71 times, growth would have been probably half a percentage point lower. That technically would have put the world in recession. We don't need that anywhere. And for us in the fund, having less uncertainty correlates to less trade tensions.
Right. Here in Europe, obviously, Brexit is around the corner in a couple of days. The IMF has forecast a bit higher growth in the UK than in the EU bloc in the next 2 years. Some would say surprising because we are hearing doomsday scenarios for the UK after the Brexit or maybe for the EU. You don't share that pessimism.
Well, we don't because we take it that the no-deal Brexit, which could have been a major source of uncertainty and drag on growth is likely to be avoided. What we do worry about, however, is how long would be the period of negotiating
agreements.
If it is 1 year, that gives predictability. The less uncertainty we have, the more investment will take place. Let's hope this is the case.
But is it enough? 1 year? Many are saying it's mission impossible.
You know, it is really for the European institutions, the European member states and the UK to decide on that. What we can say is that it has to be a good agreement that is helping businesses to flourish on both sides. Whether it takes longer or less time is not so important. What is important is the quality of the agreement that would be reached. Because the UK and the European Union are quite integrated. The UK is an island. It is not a ship that can sail into the ocean away from the European continent.
But there's no bridge anymore.
Well, let's hope that the agreement would bridge the two sides. I can see a notch of uncertainty down, but we are not out of the woods just yet. Let's hope that we would get there and with a good agreement.
Right. On maybe a more philosophical standpoint, the IMF has been synonymous with austerity policies being imposed on countries. It has started to change its worldview, I might say, and you seem to want to focus not only your discourses, but also your research on the importance of inequality, inequality between countries, but also within countries, saying actually that it's getting worse and that countries should address this issue, because if not, you're going to see movements like you're seeing in many places around the world.
It is very important to recognize that today the world is faced with four lows: low productivity growth, low economic growth, low interest rates, low inflation. In other words, anemic development of the world economy. And so when we look at inequalities, the research shows that inequalities are bad for growth. So this is one more factor that impacts negatively the prospects for more dynamic growth and high standards of living. When we are turning to the issue of inequality, it is from that perspective. How can we create better conditions for growth and for higher living standards everywhere? Our research is quite categorical that two things are worth paying attention to. One, while inequality among countries, across countries, has decreased, inequality within countries in many places has gone up. In OECD member states, in many, record high inequality, in many, may not be record high, but growing, going in the wrong direction. And two, history shows that when inequality builds up, this is a precursor of financial crisis.
Are we on the verge of that?
I hope no. We are not predicting recession. We are not predicting recession. In fact, we are predicting modest increase of growth in 2020, 2021, but not a rapid increase of growth. And now that we can show through research that inequality is bad for growth, of course, we would advocate to concentrate on it. And we also see that when the benefits of growth are more broadly shared, societies are more dynamic. And on top of it, they're happier societies.
Kristalina Georgieva, thank you very much for coming on the Friends 24 set. And thank you for watching this interview from Brussels.